Hi everybody, and I'm going to spend some time talking about the Raptor rigging here. And again, I always want to point out that, you know, here we are talking about a specific airplane just because it makes a good example. But everything that's contained in this tutorial can be applied to any model you like. And so I hope that you'll do that and apply it to something of your own. All right, so let me explain first. I'm sure you've read by now, if you've seen any of my past tutorials or even read the appropriate parts of this one, that I often will hook up what I call a base rig using nothing but user channels and channel relationships. On this tutorial, there's a brief demonstration of this where I set up a super simple landing gear. And the processes that I use there are exactly the same ones that I use to set up all the controls as I'm going to show you right now on this airplane. So what we end up with at the end of that process, for example, I have several controllers here. This one is for all the major moving parts on the airplane, the parts that affect flight, and a couple of other items like the canopy opening and closing. So once you decide where the pivot points go, or the centers, let's say, for these items, then animating them is pretty easy. You just define a user channel for that control surface, like here, this is for the left flap. And then there were published numbers that showed the deflections for these. So they go positive about 20 degrees and negative about 35 degrees. And so you just hook it up that way. It's pretty straightforward. So I did that with all the controls. That includes, obviously, all the flight controls. And it also includes these thrust vectoring paddles at the rear here. Some doors that open and close on the top of the fuselage, like these, and the aerial refueling doors and so on. And also the nose gear steering. And even the pilot turning his head. So all those things were hooked up with no use of the deformer system whatsoever, just user channels and channel relationships. I have some separate controllers for the lighting, which you wouldn't be able to see in this preview mode, but I've made a separate video on the lighting. And then the weapons controllers, that just operates these doors on the side of the airplane that contain missiles and bombs. So that was all done some time ago, and I added one other feature which is not finished yet, so don't laugh, but I'm working on an animated ejection sequence that I can just animate with a slider. Depending on the speed of the airplane, you know, I have some timing issues to adjust, but it is working in a general sort of way, so I'll play with that as we go on. So the first thing that I did that I would call advanced, something that led me to the advanced rigging, was that I decided I wanted to hook up some sort of way to read the speed of the airplane. That's why I've switched here to the Animate tab. So you see this small blue circle here, which is a locator. As it turns out, the item you want to move to translate this airplane is called Main Mover Ground. And if we look at a right-hand view, the reason that's true is that it's centered on the axles of the main wheels. And if you think about how an aircraft works, that's how it's going to rotate when it takes off or lands. It'll be from that point. And so main mover ground is what you use for all the main parts of the translation. Now, since I've selected it, you can see there are a bunch of keyframes here. I've actually animated the takeoff sequence that you'll see as a little demo in this tutorial. So if I was to move the slider along where the aircraft is moving, I have a camera positioned with the plane so we can always see it. And then if I click this locator item, you can see it reads out the speed. And in this case, it's at 103 knots. And then, you know, as the sequence progresses, that speed changes. And if you output a GL movie, you'll see a continuous readout of the speed here in knots. So let's go over to the Setup tab. And I'll try to explain this in such a way that it makes sense. This isn't nearly as complex as it looks. There are just a lot of steps, but individually, most of these steps are very simple yes-no sort of questions or math multipliers that multiply by a specific factor that I'll get to or, multiply it by one or something. All these individual steps are actually pretty easy. So here's our main mover ground item, and that's what everything else in the airplane is parented to. So in the real world, you would judge speed by airspeed, the thing is we don't have air in moto, so I have to measure the speed based on a fixed point on the ground. So there's a locator on the ground plane for that reason, and it measures the distance between the main mover ground and that fixed position in space, and that's what gives me the speed. Now that comes out of moto as meters per second. And so I have a little math modifier here that multiplies that times 1.94, and that gives me that value in knots. And this next box here is just the one that prints that value to the screen. And then there's this box labeled invisible channels. And what this is, to adjust the deflection of the control surfaces, which I'm getting to next, requires a curve, and that would be a relationship. But I didn't want that to show in my pop-up controller because the user can't just move a slider and control the speed of the airplane. I mean, I could rig up something like that, I guess, but that's the speed of the airplane is controlled by how you keyframe that main mover item. So this is actually reading the speed from that value and putting that number into this box. And what this box is for, let me explain it to you a little bit. Here are all my main controls that I showed you, and these all have sliders in the normal modeling view. You double click on the locator and the HUD will pop up. And you can see these are for all the flight controls. Whatever value comes out of there, and of course this varies depending on where that slider is, right? It might be 0 or it might be 100%. Whatever that value is, it comes out and it goes into a math modifier. If the airplane speed is below a certain point, and I'll tell you what that point is in just a moment, then the deflection amount, or the flight mode factor, that's what I call it, is just 1. So whatever comes out of our controller's box here just goes directly to that item like the flap, and it rotates to its full deflection. Now, if you think about the logic of this in real life, when an airplane is moving slowly, the control surfaces need to move quite a bit to generate enough force to climb or make a turn, whatever it is. But this airplane can fly as fast as 2.5 times the speed of sound. And at that speed, it takes very little force, or very little movement, rather, of a control surface to generate a huge force. So what that means is the faster the airplane goes, the less the control surfaces move. And that's what this little factor, speed-adjusted factor, is. The faster the airplane goes, based on reading the speed, this factor changes, and that's what goes into the bottom of all these math multipliers. So now, if I have a value coming in here, let's say of 100%, and then the airplane's going fast, then it might multiply it by, let's say, 50% or whatever. But the nice thing about it is, once this is in effect, all I have to do is animate the airplane, and I can slide those sliders to their 100% position, and it'll automatically change according to the airplane's speed. So it's sort of a poor man's equivalent of a very expensive flight control system that's in the actual F-22. And there are a couple of other details that I thought were fun to play with. That speed factor I just mentioned, that also affects those thrust vectoring paddles at the rear of the airplane. They move less as the airplane moves faster too. And just as a trivial matter, there are some volumetric lights parented to those paddles, they're actually inside, you know, the jet exhaust where you can't see them. But, pardon me, those were parented to rotate with the thrust vectoring paddles. And that's what the stuff on the right-hand side is here. And again, adjusted by the speed factor. What's more interesting is these items right here, because the way the actual F-22 works is that if the plane is sitting still, let's say where the pilot is doing the pre-flight test, or if it's taxiing at a fairly slow speed, I just chose an arbitrary number below 80 knots because the airplane rotates and takes off at about 130 knots. Okay, the thrust vectoring paddles need to move for testing. That's something the flight control computer does automatically. You'll see that if you watch videos in F-22. The other thing is, there's a combination of a sort of a safety factor and a courtesy factor. You'll see this all the time on videos where the F-22 is taxiing, and that is the pilot will input full up, which moves the stabilators, but also vectors the jet exhaust upward. And that just keeps hot jet exhaust from blowing on personnel or other aircraft. It's kind of a courtesy. But thrust vectoring is normally locked out at very low speeds if the landing gear is down. That's to help the pilots so they don't over-control the airplane. So let's take landing first. If the landing gear is down and the airplane is in the air, then thrust vectoring is locked out, so the pilot can't over-control. Now in reverse, when the airplane takes off, thrust vectoring is active up until about 80 knots. You can see this box here, which asks that question. You know, it reads the speed and decides what to do based on the airspeed here. If the takeoff speed exceeds 80 knots, then the thrust vectoring is locked out until the landing gear comes up, and then it's enabled again because the airplane is then in flight. And you know, it's really pretty simple. I tried all kinds of complicated things, and all you have to do is read the speed, pick your own number. This 80 knots is arbitrary, and you can adjust that. And just add these simple yes/no conditionals, and come up with all kinds of clever switches. Now, this rig, in its entirety, really isn't that complex for the flight control system, but it accomplishes a lot, and it does it sort of automatically. So I'm really impressed with it.